Oh, hi.
Oh, hey.
Hey.
My name's Christian.
I'm Riley.
I'm Josh. I'm glad you're here.
And I'd like to welcome you to Church Online.
Welcome to Online Church.
Welcome to Church Online.
Hi, we're the Dunbars and...
Welcome to Church Online.
Welcome to church. Good morning. We're glad you're here.
Freedom conquered, all our chains undone. Sin defeated.
Hi, I'm Gloria.
I'm Derek.
Welcome to the Church Online.
We're glad you're here.
Mercy triumph when the third day dawn.
Welcome to Church Online!
Well, welcome to Church Online. I'm Pastor Michael, and I'm so glad that you've joined us today. I want to encourage you, as we get started, to check out the many online resources that we've made available through the church website, Facebook page, and Instagram. This morning, we're going to have a chance where we can come together and worship through music. We'll have an opportunity where we can study God's word and grow in our faith together. And then we'll have an opportunity where we can pray together and really consider what God is speaking to each and every one of us. So I encourage you to sit back, settle in, get comfortable, and let's get started with Church Online.
By your grace we are.
Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Children, and their children, please favor, be a Hey, it's really good to be with you today. We want to continue in our new series called Heroes. Throughout the Bible, we discover that God uses the unlikely. And what I mean by that is he takes men and women that you would never expect, and he does these awesome things through them. God uses unlikely people to accomplish his restorative purposes. Now, of course, Jesus, he's the superhero. He's the hero of all heroes, isn't he? Literally making it possible for every person to have their sins forgiven, be given that gift of eternal life and that relationship with God. And just as the Father has sent the Son, Jesus sends us into the world to be able to share that good news with everyone that is around us. When we accept Christ for giving us into our, in our lives, then what happens is God goes to work in us, and the Spirit of God begins a work in our souls, and he begins transforming us so that we can be used as heroes for him. So that our lives reflect Jesus, in other words, bringing spiritual life and restoration and healing to all those who are around us. Let me start today by giving you a little bit of background into the story we're going to look at. Today we look at the life of Esther. She's our hero, all right? She's a great hero, too. She was an incredible person, hero for God. Esther's story takes place nearly 500 years before Jesus Christ, God's one and only Son, comes to earth. And it's a time when many of God's people lived in the land of Persia. And they've made their way there, actually against their own will. They've been exiled there. And they're under the reign of a king by the name of Xerxes. And he's, of course, a pagan king and cruel in so many different ways. And we meet Xerxes at the very beginning of the book of Esther. He's and when we do, we find out he's planned a six-month festival to exhibit his power and his wealth and his authority. And it ends with this really long feast. You know, it's like the party of all parties, okay? And on the last day of the celebration, he's been drinking too much. And he calls for his beautiful queen to come in. He wants her to kind of parade herself in front of all the guests. Well, she's not having it, right? So she refuses, and in his rage, King Xerxes banishes her. So he has no queen now. He has no queen, and his officials then come up with this idea, this quick fix, if you will. And you know what they come up with? They decide they're going to hold a Miss Persia beauty contest. Okay, it doesn't state it quite like that, but that's exactly what it was. Basically, they round up all the most beautiful maidens or ladies in the land, you know, kind of a thing. And the king, he's gonna pick the one he likes best. And of course, Esther, she's this beautiful orphan girl who's been raised by her cousin who adopts her, really. He becomes an adopted father. And he's a nobleman. And his name is Mordecai. Isn't that an awesome name, Mordecai? For some reason I like that name. And of course, Esther, she's rounded up into this crazy beauty contest, Miss Persia. And you guys already know what happens, right? Esther wins. The king picks Esther to be his new queen, his wife, all those things. Now, cousin Mordecai, he warns Esther, now don't tell anyone your Jewish heritage. Keep that all under wraps, if you will. Now, Esther, is our hero today. I think you probably already caught that, but you still need to know or meet the villain of the story. He's an ambitious, evil man by the name of Haman. And Haman is one of the king's favorite officials or noblemen. And so King Xerxes passes the decree that ordered all of his officials to bow to Haman whenever he is there and passing by. But there's one man, one nobleman who refuses to do this. Any guesses as to who that might be? All right, if you guess Mordecai, cousin and adopted father of Esther, ding, 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 you would be right, all right? Now, Mordecai, he loves God, and he isn't going to bow down to any other gods. He's not going to bow down to anybody except the Lord God. So let's pick it up, all right? We kind of pick it up right there. Esther chapter 3, starting with verse 5. It says, when Haman saw that Mordecai would not bow down or show him respect, he was filled with rage. He had learned of Mordecai's nationality, so he decided it was not enough to lay hands on Mordecai alone. Instead, he looked for a way to destroy all the Jews throughout the entire empire of Xerxes. So, back to the story. Here Haman schemes and comes up with a plan, this evil plan, right? And he tells the king that the Jewish people are refusing to obey your laws, and because of that, they all need to be killed. And then he promises the king, on top of that, you know what, I'm gonna give a huge amount of silver to the royal treasury of the king if you'll have them killed. And because King Xerxes trusted Haman's judgment, he goes along with this whole evil scheme, if you will. Esther is of course going to be affected by this. Mordecai's frantic because his obedience to God and his disobedience to the king's law has now threatened the lives of all his people. So he tears his clothes and he puts on burlap and he throws ashes all over himself. You know, that's what they did when they were in a place of mourning, and he mourns. He mourns for the people, even goes to the city wall, you know, the palace walls, I should say, and there he cries, and he cries with bitter tears, and it comes to Esther's attention. So Esther sends a messenger to find out, what's going on with my adopted father, Mordecai, and he sends a guy by the name of Hathach. Let me start reading here. It says in Esther 4, starting with verse 7, Mordecai told him the whole story, this Hathach, including the exact amount of money Haman had promised to pay into the royal treasury for the destruction of the Jews. Mordecai gave Hathach a copy of the decree issued in Susa that called for the death of all Jews. He asked Hathach to show it to Esther and explain the situation to her. He also asked Hathach to direct her to go to the king to beg for mercy and plead for her people. So Hathach returned to Esther with Mordecai's message. So he's become like this in-between so they can talk to each other. So Esther learns about Haman's evil plans right here from Hathach, and he sees a copy of the king's decree and all of that. And so she learns that Mordecai wants her, through this whole exchange, to talk to the king about the decree and to plead with him and for the people and all that. So we pick it up in verse 10 now. Then Esther told Hathach to go back and relay this message to Mordecai. All the king's officials and even the people in the provinces know that anyone who appears before the king in his inner court without being invited is doomed to die unless the king holds out his golden scepter. And the king has not called for me to come to him for 30 days. So Hathach gave Esther's message to Mordecai. Basically, what's happening here, Esther explains that this is not a good time. It's not a good time to go to the king. I would be putting my life in danger if I go. Verse 13. Mordecai sent this reply to Esther, "Don't think for a moment that because you're in the palace, you will escape when all other Jews are killed. If you keep quiet at this time like this, deliverance and relief for the Jews will arise from some other place, but you and your relatives will die. Who knows if perhaps you were made queen for just such a time as this." Ah, it's a lot of reading, isn't it? Mordecai basically tells Esther, could it be that you have been put in a place like this, the queen, for such a time as this? You know that God has placed you in your moment of time, in your context, for such a time as this as well? God has placed you in a position, just like Esther, to be a hero for him. Throughout Scripture, we learn that God calls us to his awesome purposes, to things that, you know, will bring life to people, save lives, make a difference in our world, right? Show his love, to be heroes, his heroes, right? Understand, there's a lot of good things we can do, and I'm all for those good things, but this is different what we're talking about. Jesus people, Christians, Christ followers are called to not just good things, but God things. God things. And like Esther, we are called to be heroes. Can you say that? We are called to be heroes in our context for God, to bring Christ's saving hope and love to the world in which we live. He has given us the gift of God's Spirit. Think about that. The Holy Spirit lives in us. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in his followers for that mission to be heroes for God. If you think about, like, say, DC comic heroes, I know they're not real, right? But you know, like Superman and Batman and Green Lantern and Superwoman and Wonder Woman, I should say, all those characters, what they do, what do they all have in common, right? Think about what they do and they all have in common. They have superpowers. Right? They have superpowers, those abilities that make them superheroes. They can do so much more than an ordinary person can do. And though we're not DC heroes, right, or any of that kind of thing, the Lord has put his Spirit, the Holy Spirit, in his people so we can do beyond the ordinary. We can do supernatural things for him to bring about his purposes and be his heroes. Put yourself for a minute in Esther's place, if you will. Just imagine her fear. Can you imagine it? I mean, she's afraid to approach the king in the wrong way because it might actually mean her very life. And I wonder if sometimes we feel that same fear as God calls us to be a hero for him. We're gripped with all the fears that go with it. You know, let's understand that fear is not just about life and death, okay? It can be, but fear comes in all kinds of shapes and sizes, doesn't it? I mean, fear of failure, you know, so it keeps you from doing the right thing. Fear of commitment, maybe you've been burned in the past. Fear of trusting others, or fear of speaking up when you should, or fear of rejection, you know, whatever it might be, you can plug your own fear in there. Fear is a very real and strong emotion in our lives, and God doesn't want fear to rule us. God wants to rule our hearts and our minds, not our fears. We, with his help, he wants to help us push through our fears to a place that is called courage. God wants us to be courageous. That's what superheroes do. They're courageous. It's interesting that God gives us 365 directives in Scripture pertaining to do not be afraid, or some phraseology of that effect, right? Do not be afraid. One for each day of the year, you know, if you will. And why is that? Why does he repeat that over and over again? Because fear can keep us from doing the right thing for God. That's why. God hasn't given us a spirit of fear, but of love and courage and a sound mind. Satan wants us to wallow in fear. And oddly enough, it's interesting, you know, we're supposed to fear God, but it's a different kind of fear. When we grasp God's love and greatness and awesomeness, you know, our Father in heaven, all that he is, and we experience that, there's an awe and a reverence, a holy fear that we have about him. In fact, the psalmist in Psalm 34 puts it this way, the angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he delivers them. Fear the Lord, you his saints, that's us, for those who fear him lack nothing. When we have reverence and awe for God, we have everything we need. It sounds almost counterintuitive, doesn't it? But in reality, that awe and that respect of him dispels all the other fears, helps us with all the other fears. You see, God's instructions for conquering our fears, if you want to know what it is to realize that he is the only one we need to fear. Pretty cool. His desire, of course, is to protect us from anything we might fear and give us courage. So how does Esther respond to Mordecai then? Listen to it. Then Esther sent this reply to Mordecai. You have this exchange going back and forth. Go and gather together all the Jews of Susa and fast for me. Whenever you see fast, that also means pray. It's prayer and fasting go together. Fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days. For 3 days, night or day. My maids and I will do the same. And then, though it is against the law, I will go in to see the king. If I must die, I must die. She's pushing through her fears to courage, isn't he? So Mordecai went away and did everything as Esther had ordered him. All right. Here's a big, big teaching moment. Heroes of faith invite the greatness of God into their situation. That's exactly what Esther does here. Invite the greatness of God into her situation. It's the idea that we trust God, right? And because we trust God, we invite him into whatever it is we're facing. We invite Jesus into whatever it is we're facing, right? Troubled marriage, we invite Jesus into the equation. Anxiety during, say, a pandemic, we invite Jesus into the equation. Financial worry, we invite Jesus into the equation. Maybe we lack peace or a sense of safety. We invite Jesus into the situation. Civil unrest, we're experiencing that right now. We invite Jesus into our situation. You see, you plus God equals whatever God wants it to be. But mainly, it equals peace. It equals peace and a solution to the problem. Esther invites God into the equation. She began to pray and to fast, and she invites others to pray and fast with her. She invites them to invite God into the equation. Yeah, and by the way, fasting is simply the practice of giving up something in order to seek God more earnestly, right? So it could be food, you know. Normally you'd be eating at a certain time. You press into God during that time of fasting. It could be screen time on the different, you know, things that we have. You know, we fast that. We press into God. You know, it could be coffee. You know, you want that caffeine fix, but it just reminds you to press into God. Or it could be sweets. You know, maybe it's fasting social media right now. Wouldn't be a bad thing, right? And when you feel tempted to do that, no, you press into God during that time. Instead of watching the news and then watching the news over and over and over again, take time to press into God, to pray and invite Jesus into the equation. Esther understood she couldn't resolve this. She couldn't resolve this, but her great God could. Her great God could. So she invites him into the situation. She is a wonderful hero for such a time that she's in, but only because she invites God into the equation. Esther took those 3 days, fasted and prayed, and let's be real, we're in a troubling time right now. You have to be delusional not to think that or see that. People are afraid, frustrated, disappointed, angry, hurting. I mean, people of all walks of life, right? Between the pandemic and people hurting, some hurting from injustice or racial unrest or anarchists or looters, or, you know, some people are just down because they false guilt is being heaped upon them, you know, type of things. I mean, things are a mess. Things are a mess right now, and people are just grasping at straws. You know, everyone virtual signaling, you know, type hashtag this and quote that, and facts and faith are cast aside oftentimes for feelings that are not necessarily even based in truth. Why do I say all that? It's a desperate time. Could it be, though? Could it be? Like Esther, we need to seek God. We need to seek God and invite Him into our equation. Jesus plus obedience to Him equals the solution and brings about peace in the midst of it all. Jesus is the answer to these troubling problems today. I know it sounds simplistic, you know, type of thing, but the answer to racism is Jesus. Jesus in us. He transforms the way we think. The answer to abuse of power is Jesus. He's the one that changes the human heart. The answer to violence in the streets is Jesus. Jesus in us changes the way we act and think. The answer for injustice is Jesus. It's all about you. The answer is not found in hashtag this or shaming that or blaming this or whatever it is. The answer is to invite Jesus into our lives and circumstances and pray that others would also invite Jesus into their circumstances, that God would begin to change the human heart and heal those hurts. So how about instead of getting sucked into the drama of choosing sides, that we would come along the side of Jesus, come alongside the side of Jesus and stop and pray, right? The world doesn't need your opinion on yet another, you know, article, whatever it is, you know, about this, that, and the other thing. What the world needs is the love of God in your heart flowing through your life. You know, think about it. Every human being is going to face God. He's the judge. Every human being, I don't care what their skin color is, every human being is going to give an account for their words and actions. So God's going to take care of all of that. How about you and I just commit to following Jesus and doing what Jesus would do, because He alone's the hope. He's our hope. Only changed hearts will change our broken world. Can I say that again? Only changed hearts will change our broken world. Jesus' people are to bring light, right, and love to our broken world that's darkened by sin. We are to be heroes on God's rescue mission. God has sent Jesus Christ to this earth on a mission. He's the greatest hero of all, but He also sends you and I as His representatives on that same mission. Jesus offers us reconciliation with God and with others if we will seek Him and invite Him into, I know I've said a lot, but into the equation if we'll seek Him. Now, the rest of Esther's story, can I share it with you? In chapter 5, Esther puts on her royal robes and goes before the king, maybe with a little, you know, shaking, and the king holds out the golden scepter to her, woo, right, and allows her to approach him. She then asks that she be allowed to hold a dinner party for him and Haman. I mean, Esther, she's a shrewd lady. She's got the wisdom of God going through her. Then just nights before the party, the king is having trouble sleeping. See, God's working. So he begins to read the chronicles of the kingdom and discovers something really, really important. He reads about a man who exposed an assassination attempt and saved his life, right? And the king decides, I want to reward that guy, you know, and so he wants to honor the man, but he doesn't know how he can honor him. And so he asks Haman, hey, how should I honor this in this situation, this guy, you know? And Haman thinks he's talking about him. He thinks that the king wants to honor him. So he goes all out, you know, with his ideas. He suggests royal robes and horses and princes before him and the whole city to honor him and all these different things. Now, I love how God works, everybody. Here's the irony of the story. You ready for it? The king assigns Haman to honor the man. Yeah, and he thinks it's him, but it's not him. And the man to be rewarded for saving the king is you want to guess again? It's Mordecai, Esther's adopted father. Haman, who intended to have Mordecai and all the Jewish people killed, now has no choice. He has to honor and reward Mordecai. Isn't it? Man, God does things that we never think could even happen. You just gotta love this, right? Prayer invites God into the equation, bringing about supernatural solutions. And God's gonna do that in our world today. I believe that. And so right now, in what seems like an impossible situation for our nation, I wanna call us as a church to pray. To fasting and prayer. Set aside the hashtags and the indignations and the opinions and the shaming of others, no matter where you fall in all this, and just begin to seek God. You know, our Assemblies of God leadership made a statement. I want to read it right here because I believe it fits so well. They write, seek Jesus and mourn with those who mourn. Let us follow the Messiah, that's Jesus, who seeks justice and speeds the cause of righteousness. And let us proclaim him who is our peace, destroying the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility. Yeah, we're going to open up our Monroe campus starting this Thursday from 6:30 to 7:30 to fast and to pray. So be looking for more info on that. Here's the caveat. We can only have up to 50 people, so I'm not quite sure how this is all going to work. We're going to have to try to make it happen, maybe an overflow room or whatever. If you're not comfortable coming out, you can just join us at that time at home and begin praying, you know, for these very same issues. Esther, you want to know how it all ends. Here it is. Esther and the Jewish people, this is the short version, spent 3 days praying, fasting, inviting God into the equation, and Haman's evil plot is exposed. This is what God does. And God's people are saved, and Esther and Mordecai are rewarded. Something that there's no way we can get out of this, and God reverses the whole thing. So please take time to read the rest of the story this week. And the book of Esther is actually very short. I would encourage you to read it. My point is, in all this, is God was at work the whole time. And God is at work right now. He's at work, absolutely. And he used Esther to be his hero. And God wants to use you and me to be his hero. In the time in which we live, within the context of who we are and who we're around, right? Today, let's each take a moment to consider. Ask yourself, I'll ask myself, what might be keeping us from stepping out in faith? What might be keeping you from stepping out in faith to do what God is calling you to do? What person, relationship, or circumstance do you need to surrender into God's hands so you can push through that fear to courage where God can use you as a hero? And then will you personally prepare yourself by fasting and praying so you can hear from God and he can intervene and do a miracle and use you, will you invite God into the equation? Because you plus Jesus equals what? You plus Jesus equals what? Here's the answer. It equals God's hero. You're God's hero. Would you pray with me? Yeah, let's pray together. Well, Father God, we thank you that you sent Jesus on a mission to save humanity, to save each one of us. Because of your love and mercy, we can experience forgiveness, a relationship with God. We thank you that we can put our trust in you, and we recognize that only you can solve the problems of this world. They're too big. They're too complex. People are too divided. So we need you, oh God. Today we trust you and we invite you into the equation to divinely intervene in our lives, the lives of others, our circumstances, our nation, our world, just like you did with Esther. We invite you to use us that we could bring your presence and peace into the brokenness of our surroundings. We know that you love us for you are for us. Jesus, you're for us, and you have a plan and a purpose for us. We want to be your heroes. Lord, we want to be your heroes, bringing your saving power, presence, and peace to the world in which we live. We pray all this in the name of Jesus. Amen. And amen. Well, I believe God's going to use you as you respond to this message and as you pray and fast and just open up your heart. He's going to use you in a mighty way for his glory. And if you don't know the Lord, you've never given your life to the Lord, you want your sins forgiven, you want that gift of eternal life, all you have to do is really pray a simple prayer. Cry out to God to forgive you of your sins and come into your life to lead your life. You can also go online and just check that that you need more information. We'd be happy to get that to you so you can begin to grow. Well, have a wonderful day and just stay tuned here for a little bit more information. God bless you. Have a great week. Hopefully we'll see you on Thursday night if you are comfortable with that. If not, we'll be joining with you in prayer.
I'm so glad that we're created in God's image, that we're heroes through God, that he uses us to speak the good news, the hope, and the freedom that only he can offer. So be encouraged today. Go out and be a hero to those that are around you. We would love to get connected with you on purpose this week, and so check out the online connection card. Let us know how we can pray thoughtfully and considerately for whatever situation you're going through. If you'd like more information about what it means to be a Christ follower, we would be privileged to get that into your hands. Maybe you're just having a difficulty getting by and you need some help with some groceries or some gift cards. Let us know, and so we can really be thoughtful on how we partner with you in that way. Thank you so much for those who have continued to give and the various ways that you're able to give. You're helping us be on the mission of connecting all generations to Christ through loving, growing, and serving. So thank you so much. This week, check out the many online resources that we have available through the church website, Facebook page, and Instagram. And remember that you are a hero through Christ. So go out, be encouraged, and encourage those around you. Thank you so much.